So, in our next tutorial, we talk a little bit about shell navigation with Linux. So first of all, what is the Unix shell, or this terminal that we have opened already? Basically, the shell is a way to execute commands, and it interacts with the kernel or the operating system of your computer using a textual interface. The good advantage about using a shell is that you have basically a rich flavor of commands, and you can do basically everything you want by just typing in the appropriate commands. User interfaces, graphical user interfaces that you normally have, they have always some kind of limitations, and of course you have to click, and here you type in the commands and you can run them. So let me walk you through the initial steps of shell navigation and about the Linux environment, how it's structured and used using our VM. So to start the terminal, you click here on terminal, or you click Control Alt and T. Let me increase the font size, pressing Control and plus. So that's basically now our interface that we can use to interact with the system. Okay, I can run various commands here by typing in these commands. So what is a command? Well, a command is typically a program that is executed, and I can instruct this program to do various tasks. And the shell that we use here is the bash shell. In fact, it's actually also some kind of programming language. So that means you can program the applications that you want to run to do certain tasks. And as I said, as the shell is very powerful and you can do basically everything you want with calling the right programs, you will be able to fully control your computer just by typing in these little programs. Okay, so a very important program is the man program, which stands for manual. You can use it to call another, to ask a question basically, or open the manual page about another program. For example, let me open the man page of the program man. So I say man and I add white space and I add arguments. So that would be argument 1, argument 2. And you can think of these arguments as some kind of additional flags that you give to this program man here that control how the program is running. So it will, this call here will basically execute the program man and give to is the as input those two arguments here. Okay, but like I said, we now want to run man man. When we do this, it opens this little page. You can use the arrow keys to scroll up and down, and you get information about what this program does. Man is an interface to the system reference manual. It's very nice. And you can see in the bottom here, also when you press H, you get help how to actually use this view here. And with Q, we can quit. Let me now quit this little program. Okay, so now we run our first program. Very nice. By the way, what you will find in the sheet, when you look in the sheet, you will always find a dollar at beginning of a command that you can type into the shell. So here we typed man man. The reason why we use dollar is because you see here also the dollar, and the dollar is part of your command line prompt. So I type something in, let me type in pvd, pvd, pvd for example. The command is not yet executed. The command will be executed once I press enter. Okay? And another command that we can use is the pwd, which stands for print the current working directory. Let me do this. So our current directory is /home/ubuntu. Linux and Unix type systems, they work slightly different than Windows. In Windows, you have different drives like C drive, like C colon and D and so on, while in Linux everything is under one root directory, which is called which starts with slash, so that is basically the root directory. More about that a bit later. Let me show you a couple of commands. So secondly, with any regular command, you can also add dash dash help as an argument. That will print you some kind of short information about this command. And here we get information what this program actually does, right? And we get also options. And options typically start with dash. So I could say, for example, dash L, which it says here is a valid option. And that would then print the value of this variable as the current working directory. Okay, that's nice. So it also prints something, right? If you give an invalid option, let me try it. Normally, the program will say the invalid option. Exactly. So don't be shy. In general, you can't break your system by calling commands. But there are a couple of commands that you should be very careful with. One is called rm, which stands for remove. Don't use it except if you know what you're doing, okay? And pretty much all the other commands are quite safe, so you can use them. Okay, on the sheet we have more commands, for example ls, which stands for listing what is in our directory. So we basically see what we have here in our current working directory, which is /home/ubuntu. So if you would open a file browser like the Explorer also on, you see the directories, and you will find that these are the same directories as printed when I use ls. Okay, so I can also create a directory calling a program called mkdir, so make directory, very logical. Let me call it testdir. Now let's do an ls again to list the directories, and you can see there's a new directory which is called testdir. To change a directory, you have to call a little program called cd. So I can say cd testdir, and now you see that something changed on the command prompt. I have here tilde and then /testdir. And if I call pwd for printing the working directory, I will see it's now home ubuntu testdir. So I change from home ubuntu to home ubuntu testdir. In fact, this little tilde indicates that you are in your home directory. In my case, the home directory is home ubuntu. To go back to your home directory, just type cd, and you will always get back to your regular home directory. Let me go back to testdir. If you want to create a file, of course we can do this from the shell, because like I said, the shell basically allows you to do anything. Okay, so I can create a file like readme.txt by saying touch. Now when I do an ls, I have this new file readme.txt. I can actually invoke Atom, for example, or any other editor that I like directly on the command console and terminal by typing the program, which is Atom, and the file I want to open. So I say Atom readme.txt, and it will fire up Atom with this file. So I can type in something, test, this is a readme file. Okay, and close it. Now when you do ls, well, there is, first of all, you don't see much of a difference. But you can show additional properties of a file by using the command ls and adding the flex, basically L, A, and H. We can type this together, so we can say LAH, which stands for L-A-H. Okay, we can type this together and it will understand it. And we see here, we get additional information about the current working directory. I see that the readme file, it belongs to me, for example, and it has a size of 27 bytes, and I get a timestamp. And you get also those dots. Those dots are representing the parent directories. We'll talk a bit more about this in a minute. So now we created this file. Of course, we can also want to see what is in the file. So there's another program for that called cat. Cat readme.txt will print the content of this file on our terminal. And here we see it, what we've typed in Atom. You can rename files using the move command, move readme.txt, for example, to No, myfile.txt. Okay. There is one issue when you consider file names in Linux. You can basically use whitespace as a file name, but it's not advised because it confuses the terminal. So let me move my file now to something that I say, this is a long file.txt, which you may want to do when you come particular from the Windows world. This is possible in Linux, and you can do it. And if I do ls, I see there is a long file, but you also see that it added those ticks here because it needs to escape this name. As you know, when I run a command, anything that I type after it is interpreted as argument. And here we have one object, one file that is called this is a long file.txt, and we don't want to have this is a long file.txt. Let me show this to you to not confuse you. Okay, we can use ls again to print information about a single file. Let me try to print ls, this is a long file.txt. So think about it. What would you expect would happen, right? Remember that basically each of these individual words here, separate by the white space, are interpreted as an individual argument to the program ls. So what it does is it basically will try to look for the file this, and then for the file is, the file a, and so on, which don't exist, so this will print an error, exactly as expected. By the way, the terminal is very powerful, so you can use the arrow keys to go back. You have a kind of a history that saves the commands that you have input. So you can use up and down in the arrow keys to go back. For example, when you made a typo, like I made here a typo, because this is a wrong file, so I have to use quotes. And then I get the correct answer. Let me add LAH again to see the information about this particular file. Okay, you can also use single quotes, works as well. There's a minor difference which we not talk about now. Okay, so I can go up and down. There's also another command which is quite nice. You can press Control R, which is called the reverse iSearch, and then you can look for a command. For example, let me look for MV, and here you go. You get basically the last command that you have invoked that contains these words that you have typed, which is again very convenient to execute a couple of steps. Another interesting aspect about Linux in general is that you have another clipboard. So you can mark here text. You can of course press the right button and press copy and paste, for example. So I can say ls my file, which we just renamed, and it would paste it, but we can also use the middle mouse pointer, mouse key, mouse button. So you can mark some text and you can press the middle mouse button and it will just basically paste this text, which makes it very fast in this terminal to edit and manipulate data. Okay, so now I have, this is a long file, and I want to copy it to another file, so I can call the program called cp, which means for stands for copy. If I don't know what it does, you can again call dash dash help, right? This is a long information already, but most important, it says copy source to destination. Okay, you can also call man cp just as a reminder, and you get the details. Okay, for all the arguments that are supported. Good, let me copy now this file. This is a long text file, and you see, why am I so quick? Well, in fact, the terminal allows you to autocomplete the text. So if I start to say copy the h and I press the tab key, it will try to autocomplete it because it knows, well, the argument that is expected is a file, and in fact it did autocompletion. In you see here the backslash, well, this is needed to basically escape the white space. So this is really similar here, this representation, than using the quotes, because what we wanted to do is to create one argument. Here, the first argument is the file we take as an input, and the second one is the output. So we say copy this input file basically as test.txt. Here we go. Now we have two files. We can run ls-lh. And we see both files are basically the same size and they have the same content. To remove a file, you can use rm to remove. And let me remove our long file, which I said is sometimes confusing. Now we have one file. So now use the time to toy a little bit with the command interpreter and the bash as a whole. Once you've done this, so using the commands that we have printed on the sheet at under step two. So here, as a reminder, here are the commands listed, the steps that I pretty much followed. There is also a couple of further information printed on the sheet that I will real quick walk you through. But first take your time and play a little bit. Linux can be overwhelming, particularly for those that come from a Windows environment. So you have to get acquainted with this new environment. So take your time and ask us questions and play with it. Again, you can't break basically anything as long as you don't use the rm command. Good, let me talk a bit about file system namespace now as part of this tutorial. So I mentioned already in Linux the file system all starts and is organized under a common root, which is denoted by the slash. So we can use the program ls, for example, to list what is inside this root directory slash, like so. So I, as a first argument, I give slash. And here we see directories and files that are in my root directory. Okay, so these are all these directories and files inside this directory. I can also specify absolute file names in Linux. So I can, it's a bit like when you say in Windows C colon slash program slash and so on. Here you have an absolute file name that always starts with a slash. So I can say, for example, home Ubuntu testdir, test is the file. That uniquely defines how to reach this file test.txt, and let me do it and print the content that you see. This is our created readme file that we used before. And this is an absolute file name because it starts with a slash. The second option is that you use a relative file name. A relative file name is always interpreted from the directory, which is the current working directory, which you can see by using the command pwd. And our current working directory is home Ubuntu testdir. So I can specify a relative file name, and we did this already. We just said, for example, the file name test.txt. So that is now absolutely, in absolutely speaking, this qualifies as home Ubuntu slash testdir slash test.txt, exactly as if we would have specified it using absolute file names. To be a bit more specific, sometimes it's useful to add dot slash. Dot indicates the current directory, and slash, well, is just the separated between different directories. So if I say ls dot slash testx, I will get the exactly same answer. Let me print the content. This is a readme file. So I basically say, relative to this directory, please take the file test.txt. You can use also dot dot. Dot dot indicates the parent directory. So this is useful to walk up and down in the directory tree. Let me create a couple of directories. Subdir1. We find here subdir1. I go into it. Cd subdir1. How do you get back to the parent directory? Well, actually, we know that we can specify the parent directory using the dot dot. But how can we change the directory? Well, there was the program cd. So we can use the command cd dot dot to go from whatever directory we are to the parent directory. So now, as you can see, we can walk back and forth into the directory tree. Good. There are a couple of more commands that are written on the sheet that you can go through. Like echo, for example. This is a test. This command basically prints whatever is set here on the terminal. So it just outputs this text. So we see when we call it, it says this is a text. That's sometimes quite useful. And we can also input some information like into a variable. We will learn about this in a later using the command read. So I can say name, for example, read name. This will read into the variable name. From what do I input? Julian K. Now, how about we print what I just stored into this variable name? Well, you can say echo dollar name. Dollar indicates a variable, so it's kind of a placeholder in memory where the data, some data is stored. So I say echo dollar name, and it will print Julian K. Right? So I can say hello, welcome to Linux. So how about you try to do that and then pause the video? So follow the steps and input your name. And of course, this is very powerful to use such kind of placeholders, such kind of variables in the bash shell. And you will see that the concepts are very similar when you use it in a programming languages. But it's a little bit easier, I would say, to understand from this high level of abstraction that this bash and our shell allows us to do. Right. So there is a lot more on the sheet, a lot more hints and further reading. Please spend a little bit of time to toy with it and follow the steps on the exercise sheets. Now, good luck. Again, if you have any issue, please reach out to us.